Thank you very much for this very kind introduction, and good morning to all of you. I would like to thank the Bank of Latvia for the kind invitation and for setting up this conference on such an important issue. And let me just clarify incidentally that the executive board of the ECB is also part of the decision-making body. a tiny part, but still a part of it. And I would like to thank personally Governor Rimsevich, dear Ilmas, for the invitation. So this conference is about have we learned anything from the crisis? So the short answer is yes. And I will now give you the long answer. And that will be about structural reforms. So there will be a lot of consistency and a lot of echoes with what the governor just said on the importance of structural reforms. And before discussing what we've learned from the crisis when it comes to structural reforms, let me first have a word on the interaction between supply and demand, because structural reform is about supply-side policies. It's about the same. It's, by the way, we all loosely use structural reforms as a substitute for a supply-side policy. I see in a sense, a disconnect between what has been discussed in the economic literature on the interaction between supply and demand and what we see today in the policy or even in the political discussion. Jean-Baptiste Say argued that supply creates its own demand. L'offre crée la demande, cher Christian, which he never said, by the way, so it's in Keynes' general theory, that interpretation of Jean-Baptiste Say's approach, but that more or less what Say intended to say. And there is a fruitful academic discussion on the interaction between supply and demand in the economy. That said, when you look to the policy discussion, there is sometimes a tendency to look for simple answers to what is in fact a complex problem. Some argue that demand-side policies are the only way out of the situation, out of the economic malaise. Others claim that the crisis can be solved by supply-side policies only. So what I would like to argue here is that, in particular, based on the lessons from the financial crisis, that achieving sustainable economic growth is always both about demand and supply, and in particular, that policies that support demand empower policies that support supply, and even more importantly, vice versa, structural reforms also can have a very significant impact on aggregate demand, which is sometimes overlooked in the political discussion. The way in which supply side, the way in which demand side policies can lift supply are well established from previous recessions. A period of weak demand can create a shortfall in investment. It can create a risk that workers are unemployed for too long, that they lose their skills. So that is the hysteresis effect that we have in the literature. Both of which then tend to a lower potential growth. So that side of the interaction is well understood, and the quicker demand policies can return the economy to potential, the less the risk that our living standards and employment opportunities will be permanently lowered, or that potential output will be permanently lower. The relationship in the other direction, from supply to demand, is less well established and is even more important, I would argue, at the current juncture. In most macroeconomic models, the effectiveness of a demand stimulus does not depend on supply-side measures. So in a standard DSGE model, say, supply-side measures will probably not impact the kind of multiplier that you will find associated with fiscal or monetary policies. So you have a kind of a separation here. But what is missing from such analysis is the specific context that we face today in the euro area. That is the initial condition that we are facing after the crisis. And those initial conditions that we are facing today in the eurozone include, in many countries, a large debt overhang across sectors due to the pre-crisis boom that the governor described very well in his introduction. That also includes a labor market with a very high unemployment. Part of it is structural. due to the downsizing of previously overblown sectors, such as the construction sector. This also includes excessive rent seeking in sectors that have been shielded from international competition, so protected sectors. And this also, and maybe even more worryingly, includes weak productivity trends, which were partly there before the crisis, which have been amplified by the crisis, and which also reflects the misallocation of resources ahead of the crisis, misallocation of resources into the construction sector, for instance, in many Eurozone countries, and other low productivity sectors. So in such an environment, such a challenging environment, I would say, boosting demand through stabilization policies becomes less effective, given the initial conditions. Fiscal space is squeezed by high public debt. The impact of monetary policy on investment and on consumption is blurred is blunted by high private debt. The positive impact of higher demand on jobs is constrained by the structural nature of unemployment, in particular by the skill mismatch between job seekers and vacancies, by the low mobility of workers, by the priority given to insiders, which all are legacies from the period before the crisis. And the positive impact of higher demand is also constrained by capital market fragmentation, which is very much a feature of the current crisis in Europe. And that is the inability of capital markets to channel savings where it is needed, meaning where it is needed to finance investments that in turn will create jobs. So absent other policies, stimulating demand may in fact only delay the necessary restructuring of the economy toward a higher productivity growth path. And this is where supply-side policies can help empower demand. By raising potential growth and hence future income, structural reform can create more space for governments, firms, and households to spend today. So this is a strong message also to fiscally challenged Eurozone country that supply-side policies, structural reforms can recreate fiscal space. So instead of trying to invent fiscal space that in many cases they don't have, they should focus more on structural reform to recreate fiscal space that will boost by boosting future income that can create fiscal space already today. Also by reactivating, by reskilling the workforce, structural reforms can allow employment to respond faster to any demand stimulus. And by helping the economy to restructure, they can ensure that higher demand is channeled towards those sectors which will support a higher productivity, and they can accelerate rather than delay the creative destruction process. But then, of course, the next question is which kind of supply side reforms do we want? And here, the quality of supply side reform, the quality of structural reform matters enormously. And this is why, and to understand why the nature of structural reform matters, we have to come back to this question of the relationship between supply and demand. The relationship between supply and demand rests on the assumption that structural reforms will have mainly short-term positive effects. But we know that this needs qualification. The long-term benefits of structural reform are, by and large, undisputed. But there are different views about the short-term effects of structural reform. Reforms can be shown to produce two opposing sets of forces in the short term. One set of forces is contractionary, as reforms can lead to lower prices, higher real interest rates, which will depress short-term output. If monetary policy is at the lower bound and unable to respond, if fiscal space has been exhausted, then higher real interest rates will cause the private sector to postpone consumption and investment decisions and GDP to contract. So structural reforms can be contractionary in the short term. But of course, the other set of forces is expansionary. Reform can raise expectations of future income. They can bring forward investment and consumption. And moreover, the prospect of higher potential growth will increase the likelihood of future employment for households, reduce precautionary savings and boost consumption already today. And this is all expansionary. And these effects can be achieved at the lower bound and in conditions of a debt overhang. So the picture is not that dark, even in the short term. But the key issue, of course, is to understand which set of forces will dominate and which kind of environment will make sure will make it sure that the positive forces, the expansionary forces of structural reform will dominate. And what matters here is not whether structural reforms are implemented, but how structural reforms are implemented. And this is where, in my view, two further lessons of the crisis come in, which relate to our experience in Europe during the crisis. And the lessons are that both the pace and the composition of reforms crucially matter for achieving positive effects also in the short run. So this is not only about structural reforms in general, this is about the pace and this is about the composition. So why does the pace of structural reform matter? Well, even before the crisis, there was a debate on the appropriate pace of reform. And we remember the discussion in Central and European Europe in the 90s on the relevance of a big bang approach to structural reform, while others have argued for more gradual reform implementation, for gradualism in reform implementation. So some studies have suggested that outcomes might be better if reforms are sequenced, in particular with product market reform preceding labor market reform. And have in mind the paper by Blanchard and Giavazzi, for instance, on the interaction between product market reform and labor market reform. If product market reform comes first, then it makes it possible when labor market reform comes to channel the efficiency gains and the lower markups directly to the household sector and support growth. So it's all more efficient, which is an argument for sequencing. And there is also a political economy argument in favor of gradualism, which is well known, that governments have a fixed amount of political capital, and it could be more effective if the scarce political capital of government is allocated to one set of reforms at a time, rather than spread over a wider range of reforms. What I would like to argue here is that these arguments in favor of gradualism are not always applicable to the euro area, and that they miss the specific context of the euro area. Several euro area economies have experienced a sharp rise in unit labor costs before the crisis, and this was explained by the governor earlier on, in the pre-crisis boom, which required a period of internal devaluation to correct for the excessively high unit labor costs. And they were starting out usually with rigid economic structures. So in this context, there is a stronger case to reform fast so that internal devaluation can take place more quickly. And let me explain you why. A one-off price adjustment or wage adjustment has distributional effects, certainly, exposed, but it does not affect the perception of real rates going forward. To the contrary, insofar as it boosts future income, it may indeed raise inflation expectations and lower real rates already today. While if adjustment is very gradual, it creates disinflationary expectations that build into inflation expectations, and real interest rates can rise, which adds to the contractionary effect. So in other words, a slower adjustment makes the contractionary effect of reform more prolonged. And this is what we've seen in many European countries. Countries that have enacted a more front-loaded reform strategy have, on the whole, seen better outcomes than those who've applied a more staggered approach. And in a sense, today's low inflation expectations, very low inflation expectations in the Eurozone, may indeed be telling us that the approach was, on average, too staggered, too gradual, and that it is time to accelerate. And in this country, for instance, in Latvia, the front-loaded program of fiscal consolidation and structural reform has led to a fast adjustment of wages and prices and to a fast rebound in growth and job creation. So Latvian economy began growing 6 quarters after it entered recession, and it has been on an upward path ever since. A similar, if less spectacular, picture can be seen in Ireland, where the economy stabilized after 8 quarters, while unemployment leveled off and then fell from the first quarter in 2012. So in both countries, Latvia and Ireland, prices took around 2 years to fully adjust, and they have been rising since. So the adjustment was sharp and temporary. By contrast, in Greece, in Portugal, in Spain, reform was less fast, less comprehensive. In Spain, for instance, a slow implementation of labor market reform meant that wages continued to rise until the third quarter of 2011, despite output falling by almost 5% in that time. In Greece, labor markets were enacted early under the EU program, but without a parallel opening of product markets. So this is the sequence was exactly the opposite as what Blanchard and Javadi would advise, that the labor market reforms preceded product market reform in Greece, which means that wage adjusted, that when adjusted for wages, prices, that wages did adjust, but prices did not adjust. And so the higher income was not channeled to households. The price level only began falling in October 2012. So adjustments in the labor market, in a sense, did create gains, but these gains were captured by the corporate sector and were not redistributed to the households because prices could not adjust. So the result of this lack of price adjustment was that countries experienced a quantity adjustment, because there is no miracle. So if prices don't adjust, then it's quantities that adjust, meaning higher unemployment. And this triggered a protracted disinflationary process that is still ongoing. So you have these two examples that are quite telling. So the conclusion here is that in a situation where countries had to undertake an internal devaluation, accelerating the pace of reforms seems to have been the better approach. It has led more quickly to higher growth prospects and higher current and expected inflation. This also, in my view, disproves the view that reforms should be staggered because political capital is scarce, which is the second rationale for gradualism. We've seen that this type of thinking tends to lead authorities avoiding taking on organized vested interests, such as protected sectors, and instead prioritizing measures that affect a more diffuse group, such as lowering the minimum wage, for instance. And this is exactly the reason why, despite the EU IMF programs have proposed a comprehensive approach to reform, product market reform has tended to lag labor market reform, and the example of Greece is telling here. And the consequence is not only the mismatch between the different measures that I've just described, it is also that reforms have often been perceived as unfair because the benefits of reforms have not been given back to households, which in turn has undermined the popular support for the reform process. So there is also a political economy consequence here of reforms being too gradual. So what's the conclusion at this stage? Two conclusions. First, talking vaguely about structural reforms but not doing them is the worst of all worlds. It creates uncertainty over the path of real interest rates without in tandem raising expectations of future growth. So if you talk about structural reforms, you should do them. First message. Second, while in normal times it might be acceptable to reform one sector at a time, in crisis times it is not. Fairness should be a priority, and the best way to align vested interests is to reform them all at once. That was about the pace of reforms. Let me say a word now on the composition of reforms, and the nature of reforms. The aim of structural reform should be more than internal devaluation. It should be above all to raise productivity growth. As I said earlier, the key to structural reforms having positive short-term effects is firms and households expecting higher permanent income and changing their behavior already today. And to achieve this, productivity growth is essential. Remember that in a basic neoclassical growth model, in the solo model, investment should grow at the growth rate of productivity plus the growth rate of hours worked along the steady state path of the economy. For many European countries, the scope to increase labor participation is limited. There is scope to increase labor participation, but it's rather limited. And so given the demographic trends in particular, so a major part of raising investment demand must be engineered through an upward shock to productivity, to total factor productivity. So we need a total factor productivity shock to generate this kind of positive expectations. And besides, internal devaluation can be the backbone, the epitome of reform in a small open economy. It cannot be the backbone of reform in a larger and more closed economy, and even less in the Eurozone as a whole, where internal devaluation is by and large a zero-sum game. That is why the composition of reform matters so much. We need reforms that both boost competitiveness and raise productivity. So far, reforms in the Eurozone have achieved a significant internal devaluation. Since 2009, Greece has almost entirely reversed the unit labor cost growth it had before the crisis. Good progress has also been made in Spain, in Ireland, to a lesser extent in Portugal. And as a result, most of these countries have been able to improve their competitiveness and export. But these achievements in terms of competitiveness are not yet showing signs of feeding into productivity growth. So we've been good collectively at improving competitiveness. We've been good at engineering internal devaluation. We've not been very good at engineering the kind of total factor productivity shock that I was mentioning. Total factor productivity in the region has actually fallen by 0.8% since 2008, whereas in the US it has grown by almost 7%. So that numbers are telling. Minus 0.8% in the Eurozone, plus 7% in the US. So higher competitiveness can partly contribute to raising productivity, but we know that cheap labor alone will not produce innovative firms. So there is a need today to rebalance the focus, to focus less on achieving internal devaluation and to focus more on raising productivity. And this entails probably a broader set of reforms across a wider spectrum of market segments than what countries have adopted so far. So how do we create a productivity-enhancing environment? Well, I'm not going to expand too much on that. I think the recipes are well known. This is about investing in knowledge-based capital, moving closer to the technological frontier. It is ultimately about the efforts and ideas of individuals, not governments. So public policy can play a role in shaping the right environment, but at the end, this is about innovative forces in the economy. And this is about the ability of the economy to reallocate resources, to reallocate labor and capital to those sectors where innovative ideas have emerged. So this is also about the adaptive capacity of the economy. So in a nutshell, this is about the capacity to innovate. I'm not going into the details. The OECD has done millions of studies on that, which unfortunately tend to show that Europe has not been as good as the US in spurring innovation. For instance, the size of entering and exiting firms tend to be smaller in the US than in Europe. Successful young firms tend to expand more quickly in the US than in Europe. Successful firms in the US grow faster, and unsuccessful firms shrink faster, et cetera, and there is a lot of empirical evidence here. That is partly due to labor markets and product market regulations that affect the entry and the turnover of firms. And I'm not going into the details here. But just to give you a kind of the flavor of how much can be achieved by moving to the best practices, if you take the World Bank Doing Business report, for instance, this tells you that if an entrepreneur wants to start a new business in Spain, she has to go through 10 separate procedures, while in Slovenia this is only 2, and in Latvia it's 4. So it's not as good as Slovenia, but much better than Spain. And you have this kind of metrics that show you how much can be achieved by moving to the best practices, even within our region, even within Europe. Also, our economic structures are less conducive to technology adaptation and to technology adoption than in the US, and this is also a channel that we know is favorable to productivity growth. And this is partly due to the relatively closed nature of services markets within Europe, which has slowed down the diffusion of new technologies. This has weighted on aggregate productivity growth and has trickled down, well, in a negative way, to other sectors. So this certainly calls for the completion of the single market in services. Also, this has to do with the relative rigidity of labor markets, which have not been very good at reallocating tasks and training people to move to new tasks. Which leads me finally to the reallocation. Capital markets have been less flexible, labor mobility has been less, and the ability of capital markets, as I said earlier, to reallocate resources to where they are most needed has been impaired by the crisis and by the fragmentation of capital markets in the Eurozone. So this can be mapped very simply in a set of policy recommendations: improving labor market, the ability of labor markets to reallocate workers that suggests moving to flexicurity types of labor market policies, active labor market policies with a strong unemployment insurance, improving the ability of capital markets to reallocate resources. That is part of the broader agenda of building a capital market union that the European Commission is now pushing and that the ECB has supported. So let me say a final word, and this will be my conclusion, on why reforms are a necessary but not a sufficient condition for growth. And that is, let me say a word on the kind of macroeconomic environment that is needed for structural reform to succeed. As I explained earlier, reforms produce both expansionary and contractionary forces in the short term. So as I tried to explain, designing reforms in the right way, creating a productivity-enhancing environment can maximize the positive effects, and let me add, the faster, the better. But while the full benefits of these reforms are still emerging, aggregate demand should be able to counteract the potentially destabilizing effects of lower prices and higher real interest rates. So theoretically, this could be done by fiscal policy, when fiscal policy is available without questioning long-term debt sustainability, which is not in many places in the Eurozone. It can be done by monetary policy, even when interest rates have reached the lower bound, and this is by expanding the balance sheet of the central bank and by channeling liquidity to the real economy. This is what the ECB has been doing and will continue to do. It is sometimes argued that monetary policy can weaken the incentives to reform. I do not share this view. Price stability, defined as we've defined it, as inflation being below but close to 2%, is the anchor of the adjustment process in the Eurozone, and it is our duty to deliver it within our mandate. So do low rates create disincentives to reform? No. They probably do create disincentives to sound fiscal policies. So I would partly agree, in a sense. Very low government bond yields can indeed weaken the incentives for sound fiscal policies, and this is why we need strong and credible fiscal rules enforced in a fair way across over time and across countries. Suivez mon regard. But that is for fiscal policies. But when it comes to structural policies, I very strongly believe that the level of unemployment, the suffering of young and long-term unemployed in our countries is enough as an incentive for governments to do structural reform. They don't need to have a look at interest rates. So they are enough incentivized to do structural reforms. This has nothing to do with monetary policy. So the conclusion here is that when looking at the effectiveness and the design of structural reform, initial conditions matter enormously. We've been through a major financial shock that have left us with a set of initial conditions that can only be worked through through a set of policies that act both on the supply side and on the demand side of the economy. That is structural reforms primarily, with monetary support and with fiscal support when available. Key to the effectiveness of these structural reforms is that they are fast, to avoid triggering a disinflationary process, and that they focus on productivity as well as on competitiveness. So it makes little sense for European countries to stop reforming now. This would mean taking the pain out but missing out the gain, and it would only make getting out of the crisis harder.